Today, the ego was telling me, look, don't use that continuity technique anymore. It's stupid. It's not working. It's a complete failure. Where is your success? Nothing. Stupid to even try it. Stupid to even think it works, etc., etc. But you know, it kept doing this and kept saying this, and after a while I started to realize, you know what? I think the ego is protesting too much. And what's probably taking place is that it is so effective, the ego is terrified, is desperate to get me to stop it. I've never come across this technique. It just occurred to me to use this. And probably because the ego is so defended against this technique, it just rapidly and completely pulls the rug out from the ego, and it loses its influence over you. So it's willing to engage in any sort of other technique, but just not this one. It says, this one, crazy, stupid, doesn't do anything. So after you get the ego's opinion of this technique, you might say, oh boy, what's the use? The ego doesn't like it. Well, that is the use. The ego doesn't like it. That's the why it's so important to use it. The ego will like a lot of other approaches. Oh, you're meditating. Great. Wonderful. Good. Yeah, it loves that. But this technique, I don't have a headache problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a sickness problem. I have a continuity problem. Deny all the problems that the ego has given us. Really, we've given ourselves, but we're of course projecting it onto... Well, projection implies something to be projecting it on. So the ego is like an imaginary entity, which actually doesn't exist at all, but that we believe that is responsible for all our defenses. We project those onto, and we think that they're coming from somewhere else instead of ourselves. The original projection was to project onto God the desire to get rid of reality. Is actually our desire to get rid of reality so we could be greater than reality. In other words, change the nature of reality, which is the same thing as getting rid of it. And we didn't accept that the feeling of deprivation, total annihilation of deprivation, was coming from our desire. And we projected it onto God and said, no, God is the one who is trying to get rid of us. And we've been projecting ever since. And so we project onto the ego, which is really nothing, and claim that this ego is, doing all of this terrible stuff, tricking us. Well, we're tricking ourselves. One of the greatest tricks that we use is the following. Very important to look at this, because we may wonder, why are we working so hard to sweating these little details and saying I don't have a political problem, I have a continuity problem, I don't have a world problem, I have a continuity problem, I don't have a health problem, I have a continuity problem, and on and on and on and on. Working so hard at all these facets that we work on. And, the rest of the world is scratching their heads and saying, what a bunch of idiots. Those things are little things. It's not a big, those aren't big things. That's easy. I can get past those anytime. It's not a big deal. We're waiting. We're going to get, we're going to do something that's really, when we want to, we'll be enlightened. No, easy, no problem. Okay. Now, I want to give an analogy to this. This is a setup. It's a deceit. Okay, let's say that there was a freeway, and the freeway took you to where you really want to go, but you have to get on that freeway, and you're on a boulevard, and there's an on-ramp to the freeway on that boulevard, but you have to drive down the boulevard quite a ways. On either side of the boulevard are all these shops, of many, many different types of shops, loaded with merchandise and just beautiful display windows, and you know, lots full of beautiful luxury cars, and just, you know, every possible consumer good that you could possibly imagine, it just loaded. And so you're driving along, and you see a car lot, and you say, whoa, wait a minute, wow, look at that sports car, look at that one, wow. And then something tells you, hey, no, you got to get on the freeway, you don't want to stop. And you say, oh man, I really want to stop, but okay, I'm going to dig deep and I'm going to continue on. So you continue on, just a little bit irritated, you didn't stop. And then you see this another store full of, you know, technology gadgets, and it's just like, ah, I want to go in there and check out the newest smartphones and accessories and everything. And you really slow down, and then something tells you, hey, if you slow down and stop here, you're not going to make it to the freeway. It's really important. So you really struggle with this, and you decide, I'm going to really continue on, but this is just really rough. Next store, another store that's just got all sorts of tempting stuff for you. Then a beautiful grocery store with all these, you know, incredible foods. Then you go past a boutique, you go past a shoe store, it's got all the latest shoe designs. Then you go past a furniture, home furnishing store, just all these stores, and every single one, it tugs on your desire, and you're fighting. But you've made it almost to the freeway, but you're just, you know, so irritated and frustrated. It's like, gosh, why can't I just stop just one store? You know, it's just, so you say, well, this is pretty amazing. I've gone this far. And so just as you're about ready to get on the freeway, you look off to the side there, and there is this incredible shopping mall. Just with everything in the shopping mall, and you just go, oh my God, I just got to turn off here. And let me just take a look at a couple stores here. I'm just going to, you know, turn off. And of course you go into the mall and you forget all about the freeway. What happened? How did you fail? That's a big fail, epic fail. The fail is that each store that you passed dug into your desire and temptation, and it built up this urge to go into the store, but you fought against it. The next store built up a little more, next store a little more. By the time you got to the mall, you had this massive irritation and desire that just overwhelms you, and you decide, ah, I'm so close to the freeway, there's no harm in going into the mall right here. And it trips you up right at the end. So what I have found is that we have designed this very clever trap for ourselves, in that we have it designed so that we get tripped up right at the end, right before we enter the freeway, right before we decide to take the path of remembrance of truth, of reality, of God. We suddenly veer off the path into distractions. But why we veer off the path is because we have all these distractions in the world, little ones, that add up. They add up, which ends up adding up to the big distraction, the big failure. So what we have to do, and why the wise ones share their wisdom with us and tell us, really the spiritual path is a life goal. It is a lifetime pursuit. It has to be the heart and soul of your endeavors here. Even though you may have a job, other job, the spiritual path is numero uno, and it's more important than eating. And you have to work at it. And what you do, what do? You examine your valuing of the world. I know in this book called Journey Beyond Words by Dr. Brent Haskell, which is sort of a companion book to A Course in Miracles, one of the most helpful books I've ever come across. In it, he writes down what he said that Jesus was speaking to him. And the central theme that Jesus says is the most important aspect of how you use your time in this world is to examine your valuing of this world. Why is this so important? Well, what we do is we spend some time looking at this store, really examining it. See, do we really value this? We look at it with wisdom and clarity and insight and honesty. And by working on that store, we come to the recognition, you know what? I really don't value luxury cars, a new car so much. It's not worth dying for. It's really not that important. No big deal. You work on the next store. You work on the next one. You work on the next one. In a very intelligent and expeditious, in almost like a genius sort of way. So, after you've done all this work on examining your valuing of the world, you now can drive down that road and you pass these stores, you're not even looking, you don't even care. And what does the ego throw in your way? Or we'll use the term the ego, but there's really no ego there, but we'll use the term. So you think you've made it, you're getting past these stores. And what happens is, oh my gosh, all these flashing lights, sirens flashing lights, and there's a big accident, you know, and then you say, uh-oh, bunch of onlookers, and you realize, wow, terrible accident. And there's one lane is slowed way down. And if there's another lane, you can go. And of course, the ones that are slowing down are rubbernecking. And you make a quick decision, which way do I go? Do you stay in the lane and rubberneck and say, oh, what happened? You know, oh my gosh, look at that accident. Oh, you know. Or do you just pass right on by? So the ego, the better you get at overcoming your valuing of the world, the more the ego tries to trip you up. But when you continuously work every day, what happens is when you get to that mall, that final shopping mall right before the freeway, with just every kind of store imaginable, you know, you're able to just sail past it and get right onto the freeway. You don't have all that pent up, irritating kind of desire, like I've just got to, you know, work on my appearance, see what how I can look at appearances here. And so we have laid traps for ourselves, and the traps are very clever, actually. Those, what I've seen, there are other ones too. There are other traps too. But this gives you the idea that how clever we have been. And what the ego tells us is like, what? Why are you wasting time looking at your valuing of the world? That's for neophytes. You're better than that. You shouldn't have, you won't have any problem. You don't have any problem. You're a spiritual person. You're a very spiritual person. So why are you worrying about all this groundwork, this tough groundwork? You know, it's... That's for people who are struggling. You know, you're not struggling. You won't have any problem. Don't worry. You can make it. And you say, oh, thank you, ego. Okay, I thought I was pretty advanced, you know. Yeah, I hear what you're saying. I'm not going to worry about that stuff. I'm going to have a good time, enjoy life. And I know when I want to, it's no problem. And you know, the wise ones will say, wow, wait a minute. Well, that may be so, but I'm not going to risk it. It's too important to, let me just do everything I can possibly do to ensure that I don't mess up. I don't want to leave it to possibility. I really want to just nail it completely down and make sure. So they're out there sweating the details, you know, their value of the world. They're really examining. They're just, is there anything here that's worth dying for? Any appearance that, you know, anythingness that I think is real, anythingness that I want to be attached to, any impermanence I want to grab a hold of? Is the body, any body, you know, is important enough to die for? Keep on looking, keep on looking, keep on looking. Every day, every day, every day, work, 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 work. And of course, people say, oh, wow, they're really a very weak person. They, you know, for them, it's real difficult. For us, piece of cake. In fact, it's such a piece of cake, we don't even need to worry about it or think about it at all. Because we know whenever we want to, done deal, you know, easy. We don't even have to practice, try, or do anything. Ah, that's exactly what the ego wants us to believe, just like that. Just like that. And of course, it's hard, it's difficult on the ones that are sweating it out every day, because the world is mocking them, really. The ego mocks them. The attitude of the ego toward those who are really trying to get the job done is mockery. Mockery. Absolute mockery. And it may be a subtle thing, but the ego really, there's the attitude is there of, you know, you're really an idiot. I mean, you should be mocked for your, you know, for your stupidity, your overzealous nature. You're too strict. You're really not living a life that you should be living. You know, you're dumb to have such troubles, and you really don't have much value, etc., etc. You get mocked, so it's very difficult. Now, speaking of value, this is a very crucial, value is a very crucial concept we need to look at. Because the fact is, the mind will not even look at, will not turn its attention anywhere where it believes there's no value. It will not even turn its attention there. Because it says, that's insane to turn your attention to where there's no value. Now, when we talk about the spiritual path and how difficult it is, here's another reason why. Because what I say is that the first step, all important step, is to identify what the problem is. Because only then will you see value in the solution to that problem. If you think the problem is something else, then you're going to value a remedy for that something else and not give any attention to the remedy for, you know, the problem really is. You won't even look there. So the real key is to first see what the problem is. What is the problem here? And once you finally see what the problem is more and more clearly, then the remedy for that problem begins to become more and more valuable to you. And then you begin to turn your attention more and more in that direction. Now you hear the great sages say, hey, just, you know, abide in the self, abide in the heart, just turn your attention there and keep it there, etc., etc. And we wonder, why is it so difficult? What are they talking about? Well, it's will only happen when you know what the problem is, and therefore the remedy seems very valuable to you, makes perfect sense. You say, I see that remedy addresses this problem, and this problem is the problem I really have, so this remedy is super valuable. Then you will turn your attention to it. That's the ultimate turnaround. But until any of us value this remedy, we won't actually turn our full attention on it. Because we're splitting our attention. We're saying, yeah, I kind of value this, but I also kind of value this over here because I'm not sure what my problem really is. So I've got a number of remedies here. I'm kind of juggling them, and, you know, that's what we're like. So what I have done is I've put all my attention towards what is the problem. And in doing so, then the remedy has dawned. It's dawning, and I say, I see the wisdom of this remedy. Whereas before, I couldn't see the wisdom of it. I'd say what is that? I don't understand why is that valuable? I'm looking somewhere else for value. And seeing what the problem is difficult, because the ego does everything it can to distract us. The real remedy, what actually works. Instead, we're chasing after all sorts of remedies for other problems that are not our problem at all. And that's how we waste lifetime after lifetime after lifetime. And we're so used to this trying to grab remedies, if we don't do that, we think, oh my gosh, I'm going to be without any remedies. How terrible, how terrible. So it's really a very diabolical trap. So I always stress, it's super important to stress the continuity problem is the only problem that we have. And in doing this, and you turn your attention more and more in that direction, you will start to value the remedy for the continuity problem. And that's what draws us closer and closer and closer to the vision of oneness. Absolutely. The super smoothed out, pure smoothed out spaciousness. It draws us, it draws us, it draws us closer and closer to valuing that, truly valuing, turning our full attention, say, okay, I'll give this my undivided attention. The continuity problem is the only problem that we have. And this is a fact. This is a fact. Why? Because if not for the continuity problem, we would drop all other problems instantly. Instantly. And there wouldn't be any problems at all. We'd drop them all. And we'd have a good laugh. We'd laugh and say how utterly foolish all those problems were. What a joke. What a joke. And then we'd forget all about them like they never were. Instantly. The whole universe of problems, we would drop it instantly. So, are any of these problems that we have really problems? If we would drop them instantly? If not, for what? The continuity problem. So what is really our problem? It's really the continuity problem. That's the only thing that is holding any of these problems in place. Because all of us realize, in fact, we realize very quickly that, it was just a whim. It was just a whim to try to be greater than God. It's a stupid whim and just want to drop it. But instantly, the projection and the defensiveness and the attempt to forget about reality as a way to deal with a continuity issue arose instantly. And so we've been trying to follow this path of thinking that we can somehow default on awakening from this dream and never awaken from it and just be happy with this dream and never awaken. And so therefore we say, there's no continuity problem. We're not awakening from the dream anyway, so what's the big deal? We've been trying to do that, trying to be very clever. Cleverness is the ego. So we have not recognized properly that the continuity problem is the only problem that we have, which is why people continue to struggle and really just spin their tires. It's like the rain in California, it never quite arrives. It's drying. It's tiny little mist. The streets are just barely damp right now. But you go out, you don't even feel anything, but there's a tiny, tiny mist falling. That's about what we get here, you know. Lots of clouds, but no rain. Clouds, but no rain. That's the world. That's because, again, valuing, the world is chasing after other remedies other than solving the continuity problem. And that's endless, isn't it? Because really the problems in the world are endless. Endless, endless, endless. And yet we have it within our power to recognize what the problem really is and then direct the mind to search for the remedy for that and value that. Our attention, we can turn our attention that direction. And we do this by saying, I don't have a dot, dot, dot problem. Name the problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an unfairness problem. I have a continuity problem. Whatever problem arises in the day, jump on it right away and turn it around and say, I don't have that problem. I have a continuity problem. Because every single problem that arises in your mind is an egoic, the ego saying, look for a solution to this problem. That's what it's really telling you. And that completely spins you off track. And you end up not looking at what is the remedy for the continuity problem. You don't value it, and so you pay no attention to it. So we have in our power the capacity to turn our mind's attention towards what is truly valuable, which is the resolution to the continuity problem. I don't have an upset stomach, I have a continuity problem. I don't have an irritation problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a bitterness problem, I have a continuity problem. And you can go on and on and on and on, and you find thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of problems. And you say, I don't have that problem, I have a continuity problem. And you'd be very strict. Now, the most helpful persons in the world, type of persons in the world, those in the world, are those who are the strictest people, really strict. Very rare to find someone that's strict these days. Now, when I came into the world, I was a very strict person. But the world hated that so much, I gradually softened up. And that ruined me, undid me, because that's not me. I tend to be very disciplined, very strict, very severe. That's the most compassionate thing anyone can do, just about here, other than the great avatars. But to be very strict, very disciplined, very severe, and say, this is what you have to do. Forget all that other stuff. It's nonsense. Just speak truth really directly, plainly, and insist on it. That's what's really helpful. But the world hates that. I remember growing up, and I saw how all my peers just loathed the older generation with their moral strictness and discipline and the way that they would admonish, you know. They thought, my peers just said, those people, man, they're just like the worst people ever. Complete idiots. What fools. You know, they don't know how to have fun. You know, they're uptight. They're squares. What are these people? And so there was just this overwhelming mockery of those who were strict and disciplined and severe and really, you know, speaking this, saying, this is the way. You've got to keep your life very disciplined and strict, and don't go off. It's like saying, don't ever go in a bar, not even once. You know, that kind of advice. Don't ever gamble. Don't drink, not even once. Don't even go there, you know. All these very strict admonitions. My peers just thought that was just like, again, they were just like utterly valueless people. They're stupid, so no value. They saw no value in it. So that ultimately, the pressure on me got me, you know, to kind of collapse and actually get depressed, because nobody, you know, there was no place for my personality in the world. And of course now it's, you know, a million times even more difficult. You know, this is the whole thing, hey, let's just tolerate everything, everything's great, it's all cool, just do whichever you want, you know. And it's just like it's an incredible moral, ethical, discipline collapse in the world. Just nobody even bats an eye anymore. It's stuff that would just be total anathema for the older generation, my parents, grandparents' generation. Stuff that they would just be completely stunned and completely denounce it. Now, no one even bats an eye, and it's like completely normalized. It's just utterly amazing. And so nobody really speaks up anymore, which is terrible. But the one way that I can speak up is to insist on this technique. I don't have a moral decay problem. I have a continuity problem. See? I don't have a lack of strictness problem. I have a continuity problem. Whatever complaint you have about the world, insist that you don't have that really, but you do have a continuity problem. I don't have a mockery problem. I have a continuity problem. Insist on it. But be strict about it. Be severe. Be disciplined. Be strict. Be adamant. Even be a little feisty about it. I do not have, you know, a... In the name of problem, I have a continuity problem. And once you get rolling, it really starts flowing. But to start, it's hard because the ego's blocking it. It says, no, 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 no. The ego says, there's no value there, no value there. Nothing to see there, nothing to see there. You get that kind of reaction. Oh, there's nothing to see there. Don't waste your time. I don't have a wastage of time problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a seeking problem. I have a continuity problem. So the strict people are really your friends, not the vicious people. No, 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 no. That's a whole different ballgame. But the adamant, strict, but kind, you can tell whether someone's vicious and vicious and mean-spirited, or kind, but just very adamant. You can tell the difference. I don't have a viciousness problem. I have a continuity problem. So when you run into such viciousness, you just say, no, I don't have a viciousness problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a rejection problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a laxness problem. I have a continuity problem. Or you can say, if you go into bars, you say, I don't have a bar problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a drinking problem. I have a continuity problem. So this is wiping out all other problems. It doesn't mean you go and indulge in this stuff. No, because you have a continuity problem and you've got to deal with that. And so this stuff doesn't deal with that, you see? So if you say, I don't have a drinking problem, I have a continuity problem, you don't just start drinking, so okay, fine. Because you say, no, wait a minute. I got to accept the remedy for the continuity problem, and it's got nothing to do with drinking. Drinking isn't the remedy at all. See? There's a lot of potheads out there. A lot of stoners say, I don't have a pot problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a getting stoned problem. I have a continuity problem. So what do you do? What do you do? Just stay stoned all the time? No, you say, well, I've got this continuity problem. I got to pay attention. What solves the continuity problem? So your mind automatically then turns in that direction. You say, I don't got time. I don't have time to get stoned. Forget it. I've got this continuity problem. What's the remedy for the continuity problem? The reason why pot is so popular, it gives kind of a fake remedy. You know, people think, oh, this is, seems kind of smoothed outness or something. There's some kind of fake smoothed outness. But then you say, I don't have a fake remedy problem. I have a continuity problem. So it doesn't lead to just a complete indulgence at all. Just the opposite. You start to get very keen. Your mind starts to get very keen. Then it says, "Oh, I really value what's the remedy, the continuity problem. That's what's valuable. The other stuff, I don't see any value there at all." And you get more and more that way. That's the way I've gotten more and more is all this other stuff. I look at the world and I say, I don't see anything of value at all. Nothing of value here, really. No. Not really. Not even worth a penny. Because it doesn't address my problem at all. So why would I think I got a terrible problem? Why would I waste my time with all this stuff that doesn't have the slightest value in regards to resolving this problem? Stupid. And the mind automatically will feel this way. Because it turns its attention to what what it believes is valuable. Mansions, you know. I don't have a mansion problem. I have a continuity problem. All these mansions and beautiful homes, etc. I was in a home a couple days ago. It's like the perfect home. I don't know how you could have a more perfect home than that. It's just got. It's just perfect. No flaws at all. It's just. And yes, it's nice, it's nice, it's cool, yeah. And then I didn't leave, and it was like, didn't give it a second thought as far as, is that valuable to me? No, it's not valuable. I don't see it as valuable. You know, take it or leave it. If I was living there, it's like, well, whatever. I'd still be focused on finding the remedy to the continuity problem. Wouldn't really make a difference one way or the other. Same thing with all relationships. You look at all the people in the world, all the beautiful people, and you say, wow, what if I had a relationship with them, you know? And for me, it's like I say, doesn't matter one way or the other. It's irrelevant. It doesn't have anything to do with solving the continuity problem. So it's no value there. No value. Looking at a million pictures on Tumblr, you know, whatever. There's just so many pictures there. It's ridiculous. And, you know, just say, is this helping me resolve the continuity issue? No. Oh, yeah, forget it. There's no value there. Click. All the movies in the world. Now I go past, let's say we were driving down that metaphorical boulevard and there's nowadays they don't even have DVD stores anymore, I guess, but let's say there's a store there and it's got every movie ever made. Every single movie ever produced is right there in that store and you can go in right now and get it. How easy would it be for you to drive right past that store? For me, piece of cake. I wouldn't even think twice. Wouldn't even cause any irritation to me. Nothing. Same thing with a music store. Let's say you drove, there's a store that has every musical composition ever produced in the history of this planet. Right there in that store. How easy would it be for you to drive right past that store? I can say for me, piece of cake. Wouldn't even cause a tremble or shake or irritation at all. Just right past it. No. No value. No value. Right past the movie store, right past the music store. Now let's see, there's a store that's got every fashion, every article of clothing that's ever been made. And you can go in and buy anything at all, including shoes, hats, everything, everything. How easy would it be to just drive right past that store? For me, it would be very easy It might be a little more difficult than the movie store or the music store, but still a piece of cake wouldn't cause any problem. How about a piece of cake? Not even think about it. So, see, think about it in this way. Take inventory of your life. Just do it for yourself. Just imagine you're driving down that boulevard, and what kind of stores would be easy for you to drive past? Let's say you're driving down the boulevard, and there's this brothel. Sex palace, where every person in the history of the planet was available for sex. How easy it would be for you to go right past that store. For me, piece of cake wouldn't even cause the slightest problem. Let's say there's a store that's got every disease and sickness in history is there for you, cataloging. You can go in and see somebody who has that disease or sickness or something. How easy would it be to go right past that one? Me, piece of cake, drive right past it, no concerns. How about a drug palace, a drug emporium, where there's every kind of drug that's ever been in this world and invented, and synthetic, natural, you name it, every single drug is available in that store, and you can go in and purchase or free. It's all free. Let's say all this stuff is free. Money's no object. How easy would it be to drive right past that store? For me, again, piece of cake. Wouldn't even have to give it a second thought. Not even a look. How about a store, again, that had every kind of decoration for housing, decor, every kind of decor that's ever been made in the history of the world? How easy would it be to go past that one? Again, me, piece of cake. Not even the slightest, glance. Every kind of house, building that's ever been made. How about just driving past that? Every architecture ever made. How easy to, drive right past it. Not even take a glance. No problem. How about every kind of job? You go and get any kind of job, a store where you could get any kind of job that's ever been in the history of the planet. How easy to walk, but go past that? Again, I could, not even a second thought. Just go right past it, not even a first thought. How about every kind of animal, store that, every kind of animal. You could have animals, your pet or whatever, see the animal. How about going past that? Yeah, not even a second thought. Every kind of plant. How about a store that had every kind of plant has ever been? How about going past that store? So I have to think about this one a little bit. Interesting question. How about a store that every kind of flower that's ever bloomed on the history of this planet? How about going right past that one? So I'm starting to bring up some things. I'm thinking a little bit about, how about a store that every kind of stone that's ever been, every sort of crystal, polished rocks, every kind of thing, stone. Could you go right past that one? I've been in those stores, like, granite stores, countertop stores, those kind of stores, and been through the warehouses, and they have these huge slabs, they're just gigantic slabs, hundreds of varieties from all over the planet of cut stone, and it's just like mind-boggling. Tile shops, every kind of tile, that's decor, but what else? Every kind of gadget. A store's got every sort of gadget ever created, Every sort of, how about a store, every kind of machinery ever created? Could you just go past that? I could go past the machinery store. I could go past the gadget store. The only thing I so far is like all the flowers ever been, or all the plants. That's where I feel like I might. I'm thinking about it. The other ones, no thought. I'm positive. I have no problem whatsoever. hey, food, how about a store that's got every kind of food that's ever been made on this face of this earth? How easy to go past that one. For me, piece of cake, go right past it. No thought. Every kind of beverage that's ever been. How about going past that store? No problem. I go right past it. Not even a hint of irritation or desire. No. A store's got every kind of book that's ever been written. And you could, you know, every kind of book, anything that's ever been written. How about going past that store? I could go right past it. How about a store that's got every kind of art that's ever been produced? Painting or, you know, every kind of painting. I could go right past it. Sculpture, right past it. Dance, every kind of dance. Could you go past the store where you could go in there and you could experience any and every kind of dance that's ever been? I could go right past that one. So this is take inventory. Find out where your valuing is. How about an aquarium that holds every, you can see every kind of creature of the sea there's ever been is there in the aquarium. How about going past that? I go right past that. So it's only the plants and flowers where I'm not sure. Interesting. So, see, that's my hang up right there. And other people will have different ones. So I think that for me, I feel there's a deeper attachment to like vegetation. There's some kind of primal solace or attraction to vegetation has some sort of very deep connection with us. Don't quite know how to deal with that, and I have to look at that. So when you take inventory, then you realize, you know, what do you need to look at? How about a store's got every teacher, spiritual teacher's ever been on the face of the earth? Every service. How about going past that one? I could go right past that one, no problem. If it means getting on the freeway, I'll go right past it. How about a place that's got every kind of geography in the store? You could experience every kind of type of geography. I could go past that one. The plant and flower one, I could probably go past it, but for some reason I'm not so decisive. The other ones I'm very decisive on. I know, this one I'm not as decisive. Like, well, I probably could. How about a vast toy store? Every sort of toy that's ever been in the history of the planet is in that toy store, that store. Could you go past me? Not even a first thought or second thought, nothing, right past it. How about a store that just had everything that's been manufactured? Endless stuff. Could you go right past it? Yeah, no problem. A store that's got every kind of vehicle ever manufactured. Every kind of car. Everything is there. You could drive any of them. Would you? How could you go past that one? I said, I'd go right past that one. Motorcycles, bicycles, cars, I guess you just name it all. Go right past it. Might be a little, feeling just a little tinge there of that one. Just a little tinge. Because we've had such a love affair with automobiles. They're so, you know, vitally important. to us, as is vegetation. And of course, flowering leads to fruit, food. So there are some things that you know, we have such a vital connection to, very vital connection to. How about a store with all sorts of scents, all the various incense and scents, aromas? You know, could you go past that one? Yeah, go right past that. So scents, sounds, tastes, sights, all this stuff, could go right past it. With the one issue of maybe, you know, vegetation. So when we get to that final shopping mall, which contains all the stores we've been talking about in one place, can you just sail right past that one with that? No problem. Because if there's something that's going to hook you, pull you into the mall, like maybe vegetation or flower mall emporium. I remember once in Thailand, I was in Bangkok, and it was in the morning, very early. I couldn't sleep. I was very ill. And I went to I found myself in this vast flower market, like at, you know, the dawn, right at dawn, when it was just, and it was just mind blowing. There just seems to be endless amounts of flowers, of exotic flowers and, you know, fragrances and vegetation and everything. They're just like, whoa, wow. It seemed like a fairyland. So flowers have a sort of a strong pull in that they're both vegetation. They also lead to, you know, fruit and food, and they also have they're beautiful to look at. They have a beautiful aroma, you know. So they're sort of a very potent kind of symbol. Very interesting exercise. And you could say, I don't have a flower problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a vegetation problem, I have a continuity problem. So the ability to take inventory like this is very important, and it actually, you have to spend some time actually getting your mind to do it. It's not easy. Find out your faults, your weak spots. But place a store where there's every band that ever played. Could you just go right past that, not even give a second thought or even glance? Say, yeah, I could go right past that. Doesn't matter what the band is, doesn't matter. See, for a lot of people that might be really difficult. Live bands, you know, not just music, but a live band. Listen to any live band that's ever been. Can I name even one that I would be tempted to go see? No. I went to see George Jones once, and I thought it'd be the ultimate concert ever. You know, I said, this is it. I'm going to heaven now. And it turns out that he had laryngitis. Couldn't sing. He's a raspy voice. Sorry, folks, I can't sing. It's like, okay. Didn't really bother me. Very funny. So, Even if George Jones was singing, I'd pass it by. I heard George Jones when he had laryngitis, and he still sang a bunch of songs. So maybe that was like the ultimate thing. Funny. But again, everybody's different styles. I mean, a live band, I bet you a lot of people would say, whoa, I can't drive past this place. Free concert with any band ever that's ever existed or ever will exist. Oh my gosh, they say, any singer that's ever existed would be singing in there also. Any singer, every singer that's ever existed, free concert for you, singing live. Could you just go right past that? I'd go right past it. Not even a second thought. So, why spend all this effort in your life going over this valuing of the world, which I've done? Exactly for this reason. You can just go right past all that stuff. It's nothing. No temptation there. Not interested. No value there. That's why. So you can get past all that stuff to what you really want, which is a resolution to the continuity problem. Because until we get a resolution to the continuity problem, we're not waking up. We're not going home. We're not experiencing the glory that we totally deserve as our inheritance. We're not even touching upon it. How about a place that can do a makeover for you? Any makeover whatsoever, they can make you look like anybody. Imagine a store like that. You could have all the clothes, the jewelry, the makeup, the hairstyling, the hair, the skin color, the physique, any type of body you wanted, you could get it if you go in that store. Would you do that? Could you go right past that? I could go right past it. No trouble. Think about that. You could have any body you wanted, any type of body. You could be the most, dressed up to the dripping with diamonds and jewels and jewelry and beautiful gowns and the hair just how you want it and whatever, anything at all. Any type of look you wanted, you could have it. Could you just go drive right past that store, not even give a second glance to what's in the store, just drive right past? I could do that easy. How about a combat store? You could have any type of combat you wanted. Could you drive past that store? Yes, for me? Not even look at it. How about a adventure store, like a outdoor living store, hunting and fishing and all that stuff? How about that? You could run right past it. An extreme sports store, every kind of adrenaline thing possible. Could you go right past that? Yes, go right past that. No problem. How about a store where you could go in and you could have any type of mental illness imaginable? You could experience all the bizarre, weird mental states. Could you go right past that? Yes, I could go right past that, no problem. Not even look at it. That's one that could trip up a lot of people. You think, wow, I could get into some kind of weird state and experience that weird mental state. Wow, that's interesting. No way. Go right past it. How about one that you could have be any age? Any age that you wanted to. How about, could you go past that one? Absolutely. Not interested in any particular age. For me, I have to look into this whole vegetation, plant thing. Where's that coming from? What's that about? Now, I did have the experience of going into the death-free realm, and it was full of vegetation. That's all that was there. It was just incredibly beautiful. And none of it had ever experienced any sort of decay or sickness or aging or anything. It was all flawlessly fresh. Right this instant, perfectly fresh. Everything was perfectly fresh there, but it was vegetation. Maybe that's why I have a interest in vegetation. But the vegetation of this world, let's put it this way, a store full of all the vegetation of this world, could I pass that by? Yes, I could pass that by. Because none of it's fresh. It's all flawed. And the flowers, they don't last. So yeah, I could pass those by. But certainly, I believe that there is something to do with vegetation. What I saw in the death-free realm was that never died, had never experienced any disintegration whatsoever. No impermanence to it. And it seemed to give a very inviting, welcoming, calming feeling. Like it reminded me of home. Very homey feeling to the place, yeah. And of course, much of what we see in the world in many places is vegetation, right? I mean, that's the majority of our experience is just, we're surrounded. I mean, I was just driving around here yesterday, and I just realized, my God, there are just trees everywhere. Every kind of vegetation and trees are here, just in incredible abundance. I just lived here my whole life in this like canopy of enormous variety of trees. I just take it for granted. But there's something very impersonal about plants. They're just so still and quiet and just there. You know, it's like, I don't know what to make of them. What else, inventory-wise? You get the idea. How about a store that's got every kind of medicine that's ever been produced in history? Any kind of medicine. Pills, just a pill emporium, a pill emporium. Could you just go right past that? I bet you a lot of people would like say, wait a minute, maybe they got something in there for me. I could go right past that, no trouble. I go in stores of all types, looking around. I don't see anything that interests me. Nothing. People don't interest me. See all these people, there's so many people, everyone's different. Is there any interest? No interest. How about a store you can go in and you can view all the battles of history? Every battle that's ever been fought in history. You could go in there and literally view the battle. How about that? Could you just drive right on past? Don't give him a second thought. No irritation. I definitely could. Not the slightest bit interested. How about some event? You could see every event from history. If you go into the store, every event you could see. Could you drive past? I could drive right past. Not interested in the events of history. Not at all. You could say, how about if you could see every birth or every death? Could you drive right past that one? Yeah, drive right past it. Forget it. How about if you could see every life that's ever been lived in this planet? Could you drive right past that one? I could drive right past that. Not interested in any life that's been lived here at all. How about a place that you could view every kind of weather that's ever taken place on this planet? Could you go right past that? I could go right past that, yes. A place where there's every television show that's ever been broadcast. Could you go past that? Yeah, right past it. No trouble there. So, how about a place that you could see every single natural disaster that's ever occurred on this planet? Could you go right past that? That one would I might have some, you know, interest. It was like So that one's got me, you know, second thoughts on that. And you could see every dust storm that's ever been, every tsunami, every volcanic eruption, every earthquake, every ice age, every tornado, and, you know, hurricane, every, I don't know, probably a bunch of stuff that we don't even, can't even think about. But with a little thought, I could probably say, no, don't need to go in there. Don't need to go in there. No, not really interested in that. But I've always had some interest in that kind of stuff. So, again, take inventory, take inventory. And by doing this, you start to realize, hey, I really don't have much attachment to this world. I can give up this world. I can give it all up. There's nothing here worth dying for. And this great mall that we're worried about getting sucked into, what is that? It's the world. It's the world. That is the mall that we got sucked into. Because we thought, oh, there's, you know, I want to take a look at some of this stuff. And and then we are immersed in forgetfulness, of reality here, and have a severe continuity problem. How about a place that puts on a light show? Every kind of light show imaginable. Could you go past that? Yeah, could go past that. Every type of special effect imaginable. How about a place that's got all the graphics, every kind of graphical special effect? You know, could you go past that? Yes, yes, absolutely. So I'm not sure really what is left. What am I missing? You could say a store that's got every kind of dream. You could dream any kind of dream at all. Would you go past that store? I would. I'd go right past it. Not interested in any type of dream, actually. How about a store that's got all the money that's ever been minted or made is all there, and you can have any amount of money you want, but how about, could you go past that store? Absolutely. Go right past it. A store that had every kind of atmospheric condition that's ever been, could you go past that one? I could go past it. That one, little bit, thinking about a little bit. So what gets me is the atmosphere and the flowers and the plants. The combination of those three things is where I feel there's some attraction. I'm always looking for that, like that, the perfect atmosphere with the perfect flowers and plants and everything is just, you know, perfect, ideal, that sort of thing. Always been looking for that. Of course, it's impermanent, isn't it? It never stays. So I think Juan Chempa said, well, everything that we see arising, it's never what we think it is. It's never what we think it is. Never. Very amazing statement. And it's always something else, really. Something to that effect. And yeah, that's true. In this world, nothing is ever what we think it to be. It's always really something else. So there's really nothing of value here, actually. The only thing of value we need is a solution to the continuity problem. So most people never take inventory like this, so they have no idea where they stand. So just do this exercise. If you're driving down this boulevard with these stores, and there could be anything at all in these stores. Some people, it's like chocolate maybe. A store's got every kind of chocolate that's ever been produced. And it's all free. It's all there just waiting for you. All you got to do is go into that store. Could you just drive past like it's nothing? Absolutely. No, no trouble. How about a gambling place where every type of gambling proposition and betting and gambling there could ever be is there? You can just go in and indulge in whatever type of gambling you want to do. How about that? Could you go right past without even a second thought? I could do that, no problem. Easy. So if you take these one at a time, one at a time, one at a time, then when they all get stacked up together, which is this world, you can get to a point where you can say, no, I really don't want the world. But it's hard to do it without going over, taking inventory, like one by one like this. Then that helps you realize, hey, I don't have any attraction of this and this and this. So let's say if there's like an emporium, a store, or just every vice possible, the whole, everything is there, and you know, and you say, wait a minute, I would bypass this. If it was by itself, I'd bypass that. If it's by itself, this thing. So why would I not bypass it if it's just all kind of there? I could do any and all of them. You know, think about that. That's where we get tripped up, I believe. That's the mall, the shopping mall, where it's all there. So do it one at a time first. Because this world really does hit us from every angle. You go into a shopping mall, that, you know, it is like that. They hit you from every angle in there. Me, I got no attraction to shopping malls. I used to be a mall rat. But I was really examining my valuing of the world by doing that. But I did. I used to just hang out in malls and just go to every store and just every day just look at every possible thing in there and just, you know, just like, wow. Now, I don't have the slightest desire to go into any mall. And of course, we have the online mall like eBay. And that's, again, I've done my thing on eBay, absolutely. To the point now, no, I'm not interested in going on eBay. It's no interest. Take it or leave. If you need something, you can find something. But other than that, no. Shopping online, Amazon, all the same thing. No, can just drive or go right past it. What about a store that had like the supercomputers, all the computing power, you know, could possibly be, you could have that at your fingertips. Could you go right past that one? Absolutely. That's a little tough, because imagine you could have at your fingertips all the computing power, infinite computing power. You could just, you know, type whatever you want into, you know, could you just walk right past that? So for most people in the modern age, you know, that would be like a little bit of like, think about it. But so it's worth thinking about and saying, realizing, no, it's got nothing to do with solving the continuity problem. Useless, totally useless. All the store with all the software in the world, ever could ever be written. All the software, could you go right past it? Absolutely, go right past it. How about a store that's got every kind of ET alien in it? From the whole cosmos, could you go right past that store? Yes, I could. I'd go right past that. Not interested. I don't care what ETs may look like. One way or the other, doesn't make any difference at all. So again, the problem is they get all compounded. So you got like a Star Wars kind of bar, you know, with all these ETs from everywhere, using all sorts of drugs, you know, hooking up with all sorts of exotic partners, etc., etc., etc. And that, you know, that compounds everything. They've got, you know, all sorts of exotic clothing, exotic music, gambling, gadgets. Is the whole ball of wax all rolled into one. That's kind of a Star Wars theme that hooks you. All the computational power, the spaceships, everything. You know, and people just like said, wow, we can't pass this by. You know, it's just too much. So, but for me, yeah, I can pass it all by. No attraction to any of that. How about a comedy store where there's all the comedians throughout history, the funny people? Could you go past that one? Yeah, could go right past that. How about a political pundit store? How about a talk show store, political pundits, talking head store, where all the opinionators of the history, could you go right past it? Absolutely. How about all the demagogues, all the great speechifiers? Could you go right past the store that had every great speechifier ever? Oh yeah, absolutely. Wouldn't want to listen to a single one. Not a single one. How about a store that had all the famous people in history? Could you go right past that? Absolutely. Absolutely. No trouble whatsoever. Who would I want to meet in that such a store? I wouldn't want to meet anyone. But how's that solve the continuity problem for me? Not at all. And to be reasonable, you would think you would leave out the great sages and saviors and avatars and, you know, the truly enlightened beings, just to be reasonable about that one, because, you know, you because reasonably you wouldn't say you just walk right past, you know. I mean, you could for sure, but, you know, reasonably. Like, if you're a Buddhist, could you walk right past the Buddha and not give it a second thought? Or Christian, could you walk right past Jesus without a second thought? Et cetera, et cetera. So let's not push this and too far. But as far as famous people, other than, you know, those that type, everyone else, let's say, yeah, could walk right past it. About every influential person. Yeah, could go right past every influential person. How about every clever person, every genius? Yeah, could go right past them. No interest. Yeah, so for me, the world's a very boring place. It doesn't interest me. It's very difficult to get interested in anything. Except resolving the continuity issue. How about a store where there's every kind of psychotherapist has ever been? Every therapist has ever been. Psychotherapist, whatever, any kind of therapist. Could you go right past this? Absolutely. Go right past it, not even look. Zero interest in any therapy. Or therapist. Or celebrity. Celebrity store. Every celebrity that's ever been is right there. You can meet any celebrity. With, again, other than the those who are truly enlightened, okay, any celebrity, go right past, forget it, not interested. Sorry, celebrity A, celebrity B, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Not interested in meeting you, not at all. Hey, I'd even go walk right past Willie Mays, you know? Absolutely, I would. The Say Hey Kid, you know. Yeah, he doesn't have the answer to the continuity problem. Sorry, Willie. Sorry. Struck out this time. Any person of note. You can meet anyone in there with that one caveat of the truly enlightened ones. Who have truly, totally remembered reality. That's a completely different level. We're not talking about that. But as far as anyone, you could meet anyone, would you go right past that? Yes, absolutely, right past it. Not interested. How about a store where you go in there and you become projected into history, any place, and on the big screen, you know, you're out that make you famous, because you will go right past that store, not interested. That's a question. In other words, you could be someone of note in history going forward, someone who's remembered in history by other people, and who your picture is there. You're just part of the consciousness of the planet. Could you go right past that store? I could go right past that store. A little bit of thought there, but not much. Yeah, I can get that. That's still an easy one. Still an easy one. So you search for what's difficult. How about a story where you could be victimized in any way you want to be victimized? How about, could you go right past that? Absolutely. But there's a lot of people that's like, whoa, it's stopping cold. And honestly, like, wow, why? Wow, that's for some reason, yeah. But no interest. Or how about a store where you could victimize anybody in any way possible? Could you go right past that store without any temptation or something? Go right past it. Think about that. I'm thinking about it. So there's that. Take an inventory. This is something that people don't think about. You know, it's easy to do the ones that you've thought about, but you get into something like this, and then you say, okay, let me take a look and let me see. I've not really looked at that, you know, carefully enough, honestly enough. Because the victimization thing is very primal to our situation actually here, to our whole dance of deceit. It's all the drama that hooks people on television. It's what hooks people on television. It's unbelievable. You know, it's all about the victim and the victimizer. And people are fascinated, you know, by those roles. So you could be any villain, and you know, of any type of bad, you know, villain, victim, a victimizer, any kind possible, imaginable. Could you go right past that? Sure, absolutely. Go right past it. But it's something worth looking at, that, because I feel that's something that we don't even look at. And there is some kind of allure there. That's why television movies are so popular. Absolutely. Some kind of weird allure to the whole thing. So just put your attention on it like that and say, does that solve the continuity problem? Does being a victim or being a victimizer in any way solve the continuity problem at all? So is there any real value to it at all? You have to ask yourself that question. There's no value to it. And of course, the victim is always searching for a victimizer. That is a fact. And the world is a very weird place, actually. You have to see that has no value at all. And most people don't see that. They, you know, they want to forget reality. They want to think they're a victim of reality, that God's, they're a victim of God. God's trying to victimize them, where in fact they were actually trying to, we've been actually trying to victimize God, and we projected that onto God. So playing the role of victim here is very potent. Something's very potent in this world, and what I've seen in my life is that it's the victim who tries to impulse the victimizer's psyche to get them to victimize them, and then that just strengthens their projections. To say, you see, it is something out there that is victimizing me. I'm the victim. And then that helps their projection onto God, strengthen their projection, like, I'm a victim of God. I'm a victim of God. That's what we all here are trying to say, that we're victims of God. That God has chased us here, cornered us in this rat hole, rat's nest, and down in a sewer. And, you know, it's we're innocent. You know, we're totally innocent. God is the one that's victimizing us. We're all being victimized here. That is the essential projection that we're deceived about. So it never really comes out in the world. It's the victim that it's impulsing things, because that's so central. We never want to even look at that or challenge that, because we feel, oh my gosh, if we see it, we might start, you know, giving it up, and then what would happen? You know, we wouldn't. You know, it's like we lose our projection, and it's just a continuity issue. What happens if we gave that up? We'd be faced with a continuity issue, and since we don't know what the remedy is, it freaks us out. We say, no, we got to keep this going. We got to keep this madness going, so we don't abruptly drop all this whole thing. But if you understand that the continuity problem is the only problem we have, then you can set all that down. Because you know we do have a continuity problem, and it's not going away until it gets properly resolved. So there's no way we're going to have an abrupt, just all our problems vanish like that. The whole thing vanished. No. As far as just, you know, gone. No. We do have a problem. So once you know that, you can look at all the rest of stuff without fear and say, no, I don't need that. I don't need that. I don't need that. Don't need that. Drive right past it. Not important, not important, not important. So I put you in the driver's seat, actually. Put you in the driver's seat. No value to any of that stuff. No value, no value, no value, no value. Smoothed out sameness, no problem. Smoothed out sameness. Smooth, total smoothed outness. Absolutely. If you don't value anything in this world, why not have it smoothed out for you? Because that at least has value in helping you remember reality. So then we just see just one smoothed out thing, not all the separate things with separate values, etc. No, just one value, smoothed outness is the value. It's the pearl of great price. You can watch this video instead of watching the Super Bowl. You know, I'd rather, definitely. I mean, this is way more important than watching the Super Bowl, isn't it? To get this kind of push and encouragement and see that there is a technique, you can take inventory, you can understand the issue of valuing and how when you accept the continuity problem, all these other problems you have, you don't see any more value in them, and you can realize it's easy just to pass them by, etc. And you realize that you can get free of this incredible, you know, rat's nest in a sewer here. Get free of it through accepting the resolution of the continuity problem. So I don't have an entrapment problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an imprisonment problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a projection problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a victim problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a victimization problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a blame problem. I have a continuity problem. The whole area of blame, victimization is really probably the most potent area that we, you know, nobody's willing to look there. It's too scary, because the whole game would be up if we really looked at it. We'd say, oh my gosh, this, you know, look, we're all doing it to ourselves. It's all completely bogus what we're doing. But we don't really have to get to that level. We only have to realize that the continuity problems are only problem. Nothing else matters. We don't have to know anything about the world to have it smoothed out for us. It's irrelevant. If we're going to accept a smoothed out world, it doesn't matter what's going on in the world at all. Doesn't matter what any of the dynamics are. Doesn't matter what's taken place in history. Nothing matters about the world at all. If we say, oh yeah, it's totally smoothed out. Oneness is all that I need to remember reality. What do you need to know? If everything's going, you're going to experience as a smoothed out oneness, what do you need to know about the world in particular? Nothing. Nothing at all. Not one thing do you need to know in particular. Totally irrelevant. So it doesn't matter if we don't know what's going on in the world. As far as accepting the smoothed out sameness, the vision of just oneness, one thing, one smoothed out thing, one value. See, only that is valuable because it reminds us of reality. It doesn't matter what the events of the world are at all or ever have been. It doesn't matter. You don't have to know a single thing that's ever happened in this world in order to experience the smoothed out sameness. It doesn't matter. So I don't need to know anything. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to know anything. Just need to experience this smoothed out sameness, vision of oneness. That's it. That's all we're going for. That's value. The rest of the stuff, no value to it. So another technique, keep it simple. Whenever your mind starts to conjure up some script, you know, some screenplay of interest, no, keep it simple. No value. Just say no value. No value. No value there. Just no value. Remind yourself. Oh, catch yourself. No value. What has value? Resolution of the continuity issue. Smoothed out sameness. Smoothed out sameness. Smoothed out sameness. Everything else, no value. You start thinking, oh yeah, I'm thinking about, you know, how the Giants are going to do this. No value. No value. No value there. No value. Keep it simple. No value there. Smoothed out sameness, smoothed out sameness, smoothed out sameness. Okay. And then when any problem arises, complaint. I don't have a living situation problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a situational problem at all. I don't have any situational problems. I have a continuity problem. So that technique, keep it simple, no value, take inventory. These are techniques that you can be using constantly. Potent techniques that overcome the world, actually. Overcome the world, absolutely. When you change your value, okay, you overcome the world. You don't need the world in the format we see it now. You can see it completely as one smoothed out sameness. Absolutely. That's what the great ones tell us, and I absolutely believe them. Okay. Say, I don't have a value problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a world problem, I have a continuity problem. All right, very great, that's it.